Welcome, I'm John Frank, and this is our Tech Talk today. And our guest is Eric Horvitz, Technical Fellow and Director of the Microsoft Research Labs. Eric, welcome to Brussels, and thanks for coming to the Microsoft Center today.
It's great to be here. I've been enjoying my day.
Can you tell us a little bit about Microsoft Research and its work in AI?
Microsoft Research has labs across the world. We started at our Redmond site, which I still view as home, and Microsoft and Microsoft Research have long looked at artificial intelligence as a core direction for the world, for the company. When I say for the world, I mean for computer science. It's one of the pillars upon which Microsoft Research was built. When I first came to Microsoft and chatted with folks, Bill, with Nathan Myhrvold at the time, Rick Rashid, the goal was to think through deeply about the possibilities and pathways to computers that could hear, see, understand, speak, and so on.
And so those are the core aspects now of artificial intelligence.
Well, the founders of the field of AI thought deeply about four pillars. The capabilities to perceive or perception, the notion of learning from data, to learn over time and become more flexible, to reason, to do logic, for example. And they called out as special natural language processing, capabilities to understand and converse in language.
At this point, where are we in the journey? How good is our AI?
Well, it's been a very exciting time. But I said that since my graduate days at Stanford in the 1980s. Work has continued. It's been a tough slog in many areas, especially when it comes to addressing what I would call the mysteries of human intellect, what we see in terms of the intelligence of people. That said, there have been some really great leaps in our ability to learn from data, to recognize patterns, and to press these recent leaps in machine learning into really kind of magical services and tools. And these include speech-to-speech translation, speech recognition that actually works, systems that can recognize objects in large hierarchies of objects, even language understanding systems. I say understanding in quotes because these systems don't have the same semantic understanding that we have, but the ability to read text and answer questions intelligently.
How do we ensure that we have human values as we develop AI?
Well, it's an interesting question. The rubber meets the road in AI systems where decisions are made. Most people think about AI as making predictions or classifying under uncertainty, but the idea is to transform these inferences into action in the world. When you have action in the world, you have costs and benefits, and you want to make sure that the actions under uncertainty and the expected costs and benefits are balanced in a way that resonate or line up with human values. It's quite an interesting process that involves reflection about the actual usage case. Like, what are we actually applying AI to do in the world? Will it benefit people? What are the potential harms associated with the application? You know, most systems have failure modes. We often say that any AI system has, even when it's classifying objects in the world or trying to recognize speech or do a medical diagnosis, a false positive rate and a false negative rate. And you can imagine that both these kinds of failure modes have a rich cost structure to them. And when we say we want to align the value of these systems or even the usage to human values, we often want to do deep dives to understand what that might mean, and it turns out we can do technical dives as part of that equation.
What are some examples of AI that you think most excited about? And can you talk about maybe what are some of those technical aspects to ensure that we operate ethically?
So let's start with some high stakes areas. I think that's where we can get very quickly into reflections about value. Healthcare, diagnosis, systems that can actually make decisions about therapy and treatment and healthcare is a place where we see great benefit as well as potential caution when it comes to systems that perform well, as well as grappling with the errors that might show up. So one concrete example of something that we've worked on in the past and continue to work in for the general realm is predicting healthcare outcomes. One example is building a system that can take thousands of variables off of patient records, you know, internally where privacy is protected inside a hospital, and predict for every patient that's going to be discharged, which is always a fun day at the hospital for a patient and his or her family, predict that that patient will come back and be rehospitalized in 30 days. We built the system several years back and shipped it worldwide, and it works quite well. It posts a probability of readmittance within 30 days right in the chart next to the patient's name. Now, we knew that system had a false positive and a false negative rate, so we knew we'd miss some patients, and some patients would be get special handling and treatment and interventions that didn't necessarily need it. But it's an example of where great value can be gained. Medicare services tracks data, it tracks readmissions data, and a group of physicians and data analysts in 2009 took a look at what they considered preventable readmissions in the U.S. alone. And they estimated it about nearly $18 billion a year. And of course, it's not just the money. If someone gets readmitted, they're pretty sick, typically. So you can see great benefit there.
What's the responsibility of companies when it comes to dealing with automated decision making so that those decisions are accountable and transparent?
Well, I think we have a lot of work to do as a leader in tools at Microsoft and platforms. In working to develop and make available to our partners and to our developers, as well as to our first party folks internally, new kinds of methods that give us visibility into the operation of these programs, the analyses. We want to have tools that allow for a lens on inference, so this idea of transparency or explanation. Not an easy topic, but we have directions and research going on. We want to reflect about appropriate uses. We want to have engineering practices or best practices internally and then share them to third parties, which basically take us from a data set in terms of how we document our data, to understand it, track it over time for reuse, for example, understand what algorithm we pick, what studies were done, what's the performance of these systems, and even understand what the maintenance requirements are. Sometimes we think, oh, we're going to build a system and throw it out in the world and it's done. But in reality, the world is a moving target, lots of dynamism in the world. And we have to think deeply about even maintenance of these systems over time. We have to also think deeply about this whole notion of what's Microsoft's positioning and point of view when it comes to hard questions about new forms of automation and how they might be used in the world. We have to ask questions about which technologies and techniques and uses might pose risks to our commitment as a company to core human rights, to our own human rights statements over time. And I think it's really interesting and important as a best practice for a company to have an internal set of processes in place, a committee, boards, deep dive working groups on key issues around these new kinds of competencies coming to the fore with artificial intelligence.
You've been working precisely on that set of issues within the company. Can you tell us more about it?
Yes. 2 years ago, we set up a board called Ether, A-E-T-H-E-R. Kind of loosely stands for AI Ethics and Effects in Engineering and Research, looking at challenges and questions, potential technical fixes, as well as policy directions in what I would call broadly as the influences of AI in people and society, or AI in the open world. There are 7 working groups. Working on sets of topics spanning from sensitive uses to fairness and bias, issues about intelligibility and explanation, safety and reliability, human AI collaboration, and best practices. How do we build systems that follow some best practices and going from data to algorithms to runtimes in the open world? Now, these work groups are doing quite a bit of intensive work along the lines of both new technologies, new kinds of tools we can use internally at Microsoft, as well as provide to third parties as part of our tool set. Thinking through issues about policy and how we even engage with the broader public, at times even catalyzing discussions we think that are important to have.
You've been working with the Partnership on Artificial Intelligence that brings together industry and civil society precisely for some of those discussions.
Right. So we have our internal committee work going on with its working groups. Microsoft has also been quite an active supporter and co-founder of other efforts. And one particularly that you mentioned is called the Partnership on AI. The longer phrase is Partnership on AI to Benefit People and Society. And it's a 501c3 or a nonprofit group that's led by a balanced board of folks from industry, including representatives from Amazon, Facebook, Google, Microsoft, IBM, and Apple, with six people, representatives of civil society and nonprofit AI research and AI scientists, economists, philanthropists, and so on. It's a really fabulous group, all arrayed around bringing together in a multi-party stakeholder way sets of people having discussions about best practices for AI.
Here in Brussels, there's a great deal of focus on privacy and privacy protection and perceived tension with AI. Can you talk about what solutions, perhaps from a research point of view, are on the horizon?
Well, privacy research is a really rich and evolving area for core science, core computer science, as well as policy work and their combination. You might say that data is the fuel of AI technology applications. As such, there are reasonable questions about how we can do AI while really maintaining the privacy of individuals and assuring that privacy. So I'm happy to say that some of the exciting directions in this space really enable us to do some interesting learnings without ever putting people's personal data at risk. One approach is called, I'll use a strange word right now, a phrase, homomorphic encryption, which means we can actually learn, do machine learning from data all the way to the algorithm and out to the inferences, completely encrypted. So no data is ever shared in a way that's unencrypted, end to end. This is part of our private AI work. Another approach is called multi-party computation, where we have assurances in place that let us learn from, let's say, three different hospitals, where all the hospitals care about building a better predictive model to diagnose an illness. And hospitals might not want to share data and be under obligations to not share data with each other, but we want to basically build a system that can learn from all three and then share out a classifier that can be used to make practices and competencies better at all three hospitals.
Final question. Any advice for policymakers about preparing for the new world of artificial intelligence?
For the first time in history, we're working on technologies that are in some ways pushing into the realm of human intellect, coming into places where in the past we relied and expected people to be making decisions, to be performing tasks. As such, we have many questions to ask about accountability, ethics and value and actions, notions of safety and reliability, and trustworthiness. The same kind of questions we've asked people over the years and organizations and tried to get assurances about when it comes to labor and work and enterprise. We have a new lens of computation to look at those questions through now. And it's a really, really interesting, rich space that spans fail-safe technologies, labor law, philosophy, ethics, psychology. human AI collaboration, which gets into social experiences for human beings in working with each other and studying that to understand better what it might mean for machines to work with people and people to work with AI systems. So it's just a lovely broad space. My sense is we need to get more interdisciplinary about it. We need to bring in people from different disciplines to work together. And we need to assure that people who are not technical geeks, mm-hmm. non-engineers, that they have the same or nearly the same deep understandings where it counts to address this, what I would call, civil society bandwidth gap through education, through engagement, through special funding.
Well, thank you very much for being with us today, Eric.
It's been great. It's been great hanging out with you.
Thank you.